is the year 1930. In Austria, neurologist Konstantin von Economa made an interesting observation. His patient with encephalitis lethargica, mainly affecting the frontal lobe, had some disturbances. Some had mild sleep disturbances, such as troubles falling asleep, others severe disturbances, such as comas. Konstantin then hypothesized that certain part of the brain contained this not yet discovered sleep center, which in turn is responsible for the state of sleep, while other still unknown structures were responsible for the wakefulness onset and its maintenance. Was he right? Not really. But one big thing he did for the world of science is that he laid out the foundation for sleep anatomy. Hi, Andrew here. Welcome to the Practical Health Channel. For the last several weeks, we've talked about sleep cycle, different stages of sleep, sleep functions, our biological clock, and the molecules and neurotransmitters that influence our sleep. Today, in our final video of the sleep science series, we'll sum it all up and see a cycle in our normal life through the lenses of all the sleep knowledge we've discussed. We'll break down the daily routine timeline, starting with the waking up, then getting tired, and finally falling asleep. As a demonstration, we'll take a look at the day in the life of a character that you all know, Andre. But before talking about my daily routine, I want to talk about two critical oscillating processes that modulate our sleep regulation. In 1982, Alexander Barbelli from the University of Zurich laid down a theory that two processes, when aligned, help us get asleep or wake up in the morning. The first process is the biological clock, regarded as process C, which is linked to 24.2 hours of Earth rotation cycle and tells us exactly when it's time to sleep. And the other one is process S, another sleep-wake homeostasis process, in which one builds pressure to sleep through debris builds up in the brain. The greatest urge to sleep is when we're the most tired, meaning process S is at its highest sleep pressure and activity. And when our clock tells us to fall asleep, meaning process C is at its lowest activity. So when these two processes S and C are aligned, we fall asleep. The theory is a still standing one today, though with some updates. And it probably goes without saying that S stands for sleep and C stands for circadian, or maybe CLIP, actually stands for clock. The first part of my sleep-wake daily timeline is the awakening. I wake up at about 5 a.m. and I usually don't use any alarm clock. I'm trying to stick to the same sleep routine every day, and I feel that my biological clock, process C, is in good shape. Who needs a noise alarm clock if you have a well-working one right inside your brain? On the other hand, there are two pathways that lead my physiological sleep pressure, process S, to diminish in the morning. The first pathway, as soon as my brain debris, such as the inhibiting adenosine, are cleared away during the final deep M3 cycles, my brain is more prone to stimulation, all the while having some fast electrical activity in the following REM and N1 phases. The result is the activation of wake-on, REM-on neurons from the pons that use glutamate to directly activate the brain through the reticular activating formation, or acetylcholine to activate the thalamus that will in turn will stimulate the cortex, the site of our consciousness. The second pathway, since my brain is already less inhibited, activates my hypothalamus, which in turn uses orexin and histamine to directly light up the cortex. As we discussed previously, the party-bringing orexin elevates other brain areas, such as locus coeruleus, which uses noradrenaline, the raphe nuclei, which uses serotonin, and the ventral tegmental area and substantia nigra, which use dopamine. I'm not just making random words up, they all are real scientific terms. The final result is either direct stimulation of the brain or susceptibility to the acetylcholine and glutamate activating pathways. This second pathway primes my brain so that the first pathway is more efficient. This yin-yang of the awakening stays active throughout the day once it begins. Now I am fully awake and ready to be an energetic, functioning member of society for the entire day. Usually I take some time to exercise in the morning, then I work for about 10 hours, I work at a technology company in Silicon Valley, California, and I spend every single second of my spare time studying the science behind sleep, nutrition, sport, and mindfulness. Usually my twins Max and Lisa play with me in the evening when they come back from the preschool. Oh, that hurts. By the time the sun is setting down, I'm starting to feel sleepy. This is where I get into the second part of the day, the brain tiring or the slowdown process. Since I use my brain intensively, at least I think so, the metabolic debris for harder work starts to build up. The main molecule that will start pulling me towards my nice and cozy bed is the one we talked about so many times, adenosine. It gradually builds up to a point in which the activating structures start to dim down, while the sleep-promoting structure, ventrolateral preoptic area of the hypothalamus, abbreviated VLPO, starts to increase its activity. This structure now begins to fire GABA directly to the brain and to the rest of the hypothalamus and the pons, which will use GABA as well to exhibit inhibiting effects on the part of the brain. In this state, the brain is not inhibited enough to beat me into dreamland, but enough to make me feel exhausted. Being tired physically and mentally, I lay down in the bed at about 9 p.m. and begin to diminish internal and external stimuli. This third and final part coincides with the perfect synchronization of the physiological sleep pressuring process S and the command of my biological clock process C. The clock itself, in addition to light dimming atmosphere, begins to stimulate the pineal gland to secrete melatonin, which in turn enhances the process of sleep onset. As soon as processes C and S are synced and the mentioned VLPO is fully activated, it abruptly turns on the flip-flop sleep switch, aka the central sleep switch, just like you would turn off the light in the room. Lights out. This is the moment where I drift off to my peaceful and pleasant night time, right into my first sleep cycle. After giving myself 15 minutes to fall asleep, I undergo 5 sleep cycles during the night, with plenty of N1, N2, deep N3 sleep and sweet dream REM sleep. Keeping a healthy schedule where my processes S and C are aligned lets me get a good quality of sleep as well as sweet dreams. And if you're wondering what I dream about, I don't remember. But I guess I'm in the library reading research on sleep. Probably. In conclusion, the sleep-wake daily timeline is a cyclic set of events. Almost philosophical, if you think about it. Just like Sisyphus pushing the boulder to the top of the hill, only for it to fall and start over again the next day. There are many structures that take part in this process of waking us up and getting us to sleep, and they all are well coordinated. Damage to one of the anatomical sites that are involved in the process S may severely damage your daily cycle. So, do your best to avoid getting damage to your head, especially to the frontal lobe of your brain. Disruption of process S can disrupt our process of waking up and falling asleep. These effects might be mild or severe depending on the site. Process C, the biological clock, can also be damaged, but as we talked about in one of the past videos, it can be easily fixed through a healthy lifestyle. So that's it for now. What we have discussed today? Our daily cycle of sleep-wake habits is influenced by sleep pressure process S and the biological clock process C. The flip-flop sleep switch is located in the VLPO and activates when processes S and C are in sync, meaning the clock tells us to sleep and all stimuli are diminished. Also, these two processes have to be in sync in order to wake up. There is a series of events that activates anatomic structures to either activate or inhibit the brain in order to wake up or to fall asleep. Disruption of small elements of this anatomic system may not generate severe complications right away, but rather snowball to disrupt the next series of events that might lead to insomnia or daytime sleepiness. The research master for this episode and the entire series on sleep science is Dr. Florin Hodian, and our visualization partner is BeMotion Studio. I hope you enjoyed this series. We discussed a lot. Thank you for watching. Make sure you subscribe to our channel, share this video, and hit that like button. See you next time. Bye.